Good afternoon and welcome to About Health. My name is Thuy Nguyen and I'm a monthly contributor to About Health. I'm the owner and director of Berkeley Community Acupuncture, a clinic that aims to make traditional Chinese medicine more accessible to all people. I'm also the founder and director of the Navajo Healing Project, a project cultivating traditional Chinese medicine on Navajo lands in an empowering, sustainable, and healing way. Today's show is about different paths to healing, walking the red road. Native Americans refer to the Red Road as the path of living in harmony and integrity. Many people begin the Red Road to heal from events and choices that have caused harm to themselves and others, and to practice a life of honor and respect. I discovered that you don't have to be indigenous to walk the Red Road, and that you may even be walking it without knowing it. The more I learned about the Red Road, the more I began to see red dust beneath my very own feet. I haven't referred to my own journey in that way, as I am only beginning now to understand some about indigenous ways of seeing the world, but I have committed myself in earnest to a path of healing for some time. No matter what you call this path, it seems inevitable that you will encounter others walking the same road. They may come from completely different backgrounds, different people, different cultures, but still traveling the same road. I met William Verburg as a patient in Window Rock, Arizona, where I set up biannual traditional Chinese medicine clinics for the Diné community. During these clinics, I see up to 50 patients a day, so it's quite packed, and I don't get to spend a lot of time chatting. I usually scan intake forms, have a quick check-in, and do my best under the circumstances to give them some relief through acupuncture. I barely remember the check-in with William, but I do remember when I asked him to follow me to the treatment chair, I heard him say, "Jiao Guo." It stopped me in my tracks, and I retorted, "What did you say to me?" I thought I heard him speak Vietnamese, but it didn't compute, and I wanted to be sure I heard right. He repeated, "Jiao Guo," which is a general greeting. I focused on my eyes on him, looked him up and down, and said, "You're Vietnamese?" He was quite tall, with a formidable presence, piercing eyes, and graying hair that was pulled back into a short braid. Everything at first glance told me he was Navajo, but when I heard him speak Vietnamese, I did a double take. Could he be Vietnamese, I wondered. "My mom's Vietnamese," he replied. "Huh," I thought. I often think Navajo people look Asian anyway, and I myself am sometimes taken as Navajo when I'm there. But to hear someone speak Vietnamese confused my brain just a little bit. After that, we became quick friends. A natural resonance grew between us, not just because we are both Vietnamese, but also a mutual recognition that we are both traveling an unusual healing road that has landed us in that moment in Window Rock, Arizona. I discovered that Will is a sun dancer. Sun dancers are men who pledge to undergo rigorous activities of fasting and dancing in a sacred indigenous ritual of personal and community sacrifice for healing. He recounted to me many mind-blowing experiences. Equally as astonishing, I learned that he makes really yummy Vietnamese food and sells pho on the weekends at the Gallup flea market. There were interesting complexities about him, and in many ways, I felt a kinship with that complexity. I myself have traveled an unusual healing road that has landed me in many interesting places. It was then that I knew I wanted to sit with Will for an interview, not just to discover his story, but through that to help uncover my own and to shed light on the many healing paths we all take in life. I'm curious about your personal healing journey, like you've mentioned it a lot.
Oh, yeah. The whole point, okay, so my first wife and I, when I started going to purity ceremonies, I prayed, I said, because I grew up with a lot of abandonment issues. huge amount of abandonment issues.
Because you were abandoned?
I was put in boarding school for 8 years, and I didn't get to see my mom, didn't get to see my dad.
Who put you in boarding school?
My dad's parents. Because you got to realize my mom and my dad got married in the late 60s, right? Uh-huh. In the middle of the Vietnam War. Uh-huh. So here's a white man marrying a Vietnamese woman. And my Dutch side of the family, they were of the idea that white is right. You should have married your own kind.
Right.
And with that was animosity towards my mom. Always been. Once she got married into it, my grandma wasn't kind. And so her way to disrupt our family life was to put us in boarding school.
I mean, it's interesting your history with boarding schools and your wife being Navajo.
Well, interesting because all Native cultures
exactly
is the same way.
Right.
Even in Hawaii,
right.
I can relate to them.
Right.
I was in boarding school too. I understand.
So you were talking about abandonment issues.
Yeah.
What else was felt like it was like you were asking for healing for?
The amount of animosity, hatred towards my mom created a lot of toxic environment, and all that stuff manifests itself. All that energy gets stuck in my body. You know, well, my
how did you feel it?
Well, I was always angry. Mm-hmm. Always angry. Mm-hmm. Angry boy. Angry. I prayed and I said, God, before I ever have a child, please do not let me have a child until I'm healed. Please. I don't care how long it takes. I'm not ready. I don't want to pass this stuff to them. My job is to clean it up so they have nothing to do with it. At least from this point back. This point forward, that's my responsibility.
There was a clarity to Will's understanding of his childhood that felt refreshing. A clear seeing and naming of the events that created conflict, anger, and a yearning for healing. In modern biomedicine, this type of discomfort isn't recognized as illness that needs healing. Illness isn't recognized until it is registered on tests or manifests as physical illness. What Will is talking about is ancestral, spiritual, emotional trauma. At best, this is recognized by modern medicine in psychotherapeutic settings, and results of that type of treatment are mixed. Other alternative forms of addressing these things are mostly written off by mainstream medicine. And yet, it was clear to me that what Will was talking about is an affliction most all of us suffer from, the trauma of disconnect. Disconnect from what? In Will's case, he's talking about his mother. The forced detachment from a parent is one of the most brutal traumas a child can undergo. And there are other fundamental areas where our sense of wholeness, peace, and security can be threatened if we are not allowed a natural, healthy bonding and connection to these things. All of the people and things that we come from, our parents, clearly, and other things that literally and otherwise make us who we are, that is taken for granted or not recognized by modern society. The land, which doesn't just give us our footing, but our food and our medicine, and so many other things, most of us are disconnected from in modern life. Our connection to something greater than ourselves, creator, or we can just say the great mystery, many of us are disconnected from a spiritual connection in modern life. If we are disconnected from these fundamental aspects from which our very own life emerges, creator, nature, appearance, then we will feel something fundamental missing, and it might feel like a nagging emptiness, a hunger, a low-grade fear and sadness, restlessness, a constant searching. These invisible afflictions live in our bodies, and addressing them can not only help one's own health, but can keep us from passing it on to subsequent generations. Unfortunately, we normalize such feelings of disconnect and are even encouraged to be in denial or disconnect even further to deal with difficult feelings. When Will mentioned boarding schools, I immediately made the connection between his experience and the horrific, brutal history of Diné children forced into boarding schools by the government to willfully destroy families and erase knowledge and connection. Is that part of what brought Will to make Navajo lands his home? I believe that what calls for healing inside us attracts us to people and places that call for similar healing, and that we can learn from each other and heal together what may be too difficult for us to confront by ourselves. I remembered the first time I found myself in a Navajo healing ceremony. A sense of emptiness and disconnect led me there, but I couldn't quite put my finger on why. From all accounts, I was a perfectly healthy person, but inside, there wasn't a true sense of peace or rootedness. I had a feeling that maybe there would be knowledge in the healing ceremony that would shed light on this for me. That night, so many things came to light, including my sense of displacement due to the Vietnam War. Present were Diné people whose relatives were killed in that war. They prayed for me all night long. By that time, I had been practicing traditional Chinese medicine for 15 years, but it wasn't until that point did I begin to understand the depths of healing or medicine. That experience changed my life. And so hearing Will's story, I had a real appreciation of his path to healing. He reflected on the beginning of that journey.
The first prayer happened when I was 16. I read my first article on the greenhouse effect. And at that point, I was there inside the place. I prayed and I said, Creator, I want my life to be about this. I want my life to do something about this.
Be about this. What's this?
Like helping creation, helping keep us alive. So I had a girlfriend when I was 21. She was going to college. She offered me to read this book. So she gave me this book called Black Elk Speaks. I read that book and it changed my life.
Wait, what's that book about?
The Red Road.
Tell me what does it mean to start going on the Red Road? And what's the Red Road?
The Red Road is the healing road.
Why is it red?
That's what they call it. Red. I guess what they call it, the Red Road, because it's the indigenous road. That's with blood, right? With heart. There's a heart on that road. And it starts off really wide. And then the longer you go onto it, it gets really narrow. And then there's not so many people with you.
Yeah.
So that's where I'm at. I'm like, I have a narrow passage. And the people I do meet there, I cherish. I cherish everybody I meet there, you know, for self-healing and enlightenment. That's the road. And that got me closer to Mother Earth. That got me closer to God.
You read that book.
I read that book. Then after I read that book, I stopped drinking. I was a bartender. I didn't want to drink. No more. Then I had a roommate who was a mushroom dealer. I used to eat a lot of mushrooms, and I used to go dancing high as mushrooms. And I had a blast. I was like in LA, but then that mushroom allowed me to connect to nature, even though I was in the concrete jungle. And I used to go dancing, get my body all painted, those glow-in-the-dark paints, get all tribaled out. I didn't have no sense of direction, so I just went on that. And then I went to my first sweat. And that's when I knew, yeah, this is what I want. This is it right here. Then it took me another year to go to my next sweat. That next sweat was Black Elk, the new generation Black Elk. He passed away a few years ago. He said, come back on Sunday. And I, at that point, I was on it. Once I went to the sweat, once I went to purity meetings, I was done. I was done with the party life. I was done with the nightclubs. I was done with the raves. I was done with all of it. Because I found what I needed, and I found what made me happy.
Black Elk Speaks is a book written in the 1930s by John G. Neihardt, an American poet and writer, who relates the story of the life of Black Elk, a Lakota medicine man. The degree of accuracy of reporting of Lakota culture and beliefs is debatable, but what is clear is the strong, enduring spiritual messages and inspiration that the book represents for many readers. In the book, Black Elk recounts a great vision that he had when he was just a boy, of a grandfather bestowing him with power upon his path. Here's an excerpt from the book. Behold, the living center of a nation I shall give you, and with it many you shall save. And I saw that he was holding in his hand a bright red stick that was alive. And as I looked, it sprouted at the top and sent forth branches. And on the branches, many leaves came out and murmured, and in the leaves the birds began to sing. And then for just a little while, I thought I saw beneath it in the shade the circled villages of people, and every living thing with roots or legs or wings, and all were happy. "It shall stand in the center of the nation's circle," said the grandfather, "a cane to walk with and a people's heart, and by your powers you shall make it blossom." Then when he had been still a little while to hear the bird sing, he spoke again. "Behold the earth." So I looked down and saw it lying yonder like a hoop of peoples, and in the center bloomed the holy stick that was a tree. And where it stood, there crossed two roads, a red one and a black. From where the giant lives, the north, to where you always face, the south, the red road goes, the road of good, the grandfather said. And it on it you shall your nation walk. The black road goes from where the thunder beings live, the west, to where the sun continually shines, the east, a fearful road, a road of troubles and of war. On this also you shall walk. You're listening to KPFA's About Health. My name is Thuy Nguyen. I'm talking to William Verburg about his journey walking the Red Road, an indigenous road of healing. Through prayer at 16 and reading Black Elk Speaks, Will chose to walk the Red Road. This road included sweat lodges, peyote meetings, and later sun dancing. Historically, the power of these ceremonies must have been felt even by outsiders because they were outlawed in a systematic attempt to desecrate indigenous wisdom and to further erase the indigenous peoples. These practices are now protected under American Indian Religious Freedom Act of 1978, and yet a more insidious form of erasure continues. From modern biomedical perspective, these forms of healing make no sense. They're relegated to compartments like cultural or spiritual practices at best, quackery and superstition at worst. To degrade wisdom, even if it's unconscious, to such a degree not only continues to harm and disrespect the people and traditions it's aimed at, but also degrades the person who is arrogant and ignorant enough to presume they understand what it is they are judging. This is the foundation of white supremacy. And that unquestioned foundation of degradation and supremacy has led white people to commit the most inhumane acts of aggression and violence against the indigenous population that continues this day.
Hey, hey, hey.
That song is sung by Joshua Dixon. He tells me it's a song sung at healing ceremonies. It came about during the time when many Navajo men left the reservation to work for the various companies. For many, it was their first time being around white people and leaving their homelands. Its lyrics are, "My beautiful land is being remembered. To now walk over it is my desire. To now walk over it is my deepest desire." Joshua goes on to say, "As Navajo people, we know that our bodies are made from the soil, the Mother Earth. And so when this song is being sung, it is as if one reminds themselves of this, as they picture the beautiful mesas and beautiful turquoise skies, and how it feels to walk over the earth. That is what the song is about." I listen to this song, and something deep inside me is touched. I left my homeland when I was just 3 years old, and I remember the many years of mourning my parents went through, always waiting for the day that they can return to their homeland. To lose the land of your ancestors, what a deep sense of loss and disconnect that must have been for them. And for me as a small child, not quite understanding what that means, but to feel such deep grief. I didn't know that that loss was also in my own memory, so how could I have remedied it? No one taught me the importance of that type of connection to my wholeness, so how could I find healing for that missing piece? And there are other essential pieces to our wholeness that are not taught, are even important or relevant. And so we go on feeling this emptiness and constantly searching or reaching for things to fill that void or numb the pain of loss. For those like myself and Will who can catch a glimmer of the tremendous wisdom and healing potential of these ceremonies, walking the red road with respect and sincerity can yield healing on more profound and subtle realms before they become the physical manifestations that modern medicine prides itself on combating. These ceremonies offer healing and insight into all these things, but consciously continuing on a path of healing is not a thing done to you. It's a conscious decision to keep going on that road.
You know, at first it's all nice and beautiful, but then the further you go, the heavier the deeper the healing, and the ugly stuff comes up from your past. That you have to forgive, like truly, truly forgive in order to shed it off. Yeah, just gone. Yeah, but until you reach that point, you're not gonna learn. You're not gonna move. You're not gonna make progress.
What were some of those things for you?
My dad, my abandonment issues with him. That was the main one.
You had to forgive him?
Yeah, and understand how it was for him. What motivated him? What made him make those choices, make those decisions? I know he loves me. I know it for sure. I can feel him right now. You know, and whenever in ceremonies, the spirits will come. I say, "I love you, Dad, but you're still an ass."
As I listened to Will talk, his love for his father was palpable, and I could sense a relationship that was truly healed. I could feel the weight of the work he's done to get to that place and thought about the depths of the Red Road. I thought about all the people I know with parental issues and years upon years of psychotherapy, and sometimes it feels like the best a person can do through psychotherapy is cut their losses and learn techniques to protect themselves from further harm. But true, lasting, and palpable healing and love that emerges from such painful issues are rare indeed. And I asked Will about that.
People talk about that stuff in psychotherapeutic settings, and they feel like they're aware of it. You know what I'm saying? Like, abandonment issues is just something people throw around, and, oh, yeah, the idea of forgiveness. Or,
yeah, exactly, idea.
And so what happened to you where it wasn't just an idea? What is true forgiveness, you know?
Well, the hardest lesson I know in life is true forgiveness. You can talk about it, write about it, speak about it.
Yeah, there's a lot of that.
Debate about it, whatever. But right. Until you reached it, you don't know shit. You're not even close. And once you do, you'll break down and cry. That energy comes into a real physical manifestation, and that's through your tears. That's how you know, because that's your own body expressing it, right? That energy, it's like, was it E equals MC squared? Energy equals mass? There it is. Once that energy's there, your body's gonna transform it into a physical manifestation so you see it for yourself. It's done. It's the proof you needed.
True forgiveness? What does it mean? In my own life, forgiveness is a natural outcome of humility. To put one's own ideas of what is right and just aside, and to sincerely feel that the person before you did all they knew how to do at the time, and even if it were hurtful, that there's nothing else that could have been done because it wasn't done, and to start anew. Learning to sincerely forgive others gives us the opportunity to forgive ourselves and helps us to see that we are all flawed and that we are all still worthy of forgiveness, redemption, and love. In a world where ideas of rights and wrongs have become so rigid, blame and shame seem to be commonplace, and forgiveness and humility are quite rare.
So where are you in your healing journey now? Are there specific things that you're working with? Like you were talking about, it just gets more and more intense and more things come up for forgiveness or what?
No, I'm pretty, things come up and I have to just accept it and pretty much comes to terms with it and forgive them for not knowing what they're doing. It's kind of like what Christ said.
Forgive like what?
Like Christ, I says, forgive them for they know not what they do.
Yeah.
Same thing. I'm at that point. I'm like, okay, they don't know. I can't hold a grudge. There's no point. They're too dumb to see it. They won't look at it. They won't acknowledge it. That's the worst part is when they don't acknowledge it. They just pretend it's not there. They don't want to deal with it. So they lack the courage to humble themselves.
They your people or random strangers?
People. Yeah. My people. Your people, whoever, society. I mean, it goes from my inner circle out. My brother, my mom.
So then the
out.
Practice is to keep loving them.
Yeah, then the practice is to be patient with them because sometimes you expect more out of them and they're not making it and you just get frustrated. So it sucks because you have expectations and you like, don't expect. That sucks because I know their potential. You know,
yeah.
One of the things that I heard, God is always disappointed with human beings because he knows our potential. And when we don't consciously do something to reach that potential, it's like, why did I waste my time? But I love you and I'll give you the time. A lot of times what happens is they get misguided. A lot of the population is misguided. And that's purpose. There's a purpose for that. That's that dark manifesting itself into that confusion, distraction. You know, it's light versus darkness. It's just a spiritual war. It's always been.
I think the thing about God that I always come to and surprises me is God's eternal patience.
Mm-hmm.
Because there's never a lack of lesson and support, even in the pain, like you were saying.
Mm-hmm.
And because there's never a lack of patience, I believe that God does believe in our potential.
Mm-hmm.
It's not conditional like that.
No. But his helpers, his angels, they're a different story.
Who are his helpers?
Spirits.
Yeah, I don't know about that.
Okay. Oh, they...
I mean, I'm a little scared of them. Like, people are enough to handle, you know?
Yeah.
Talking about spirituality is something that I'm quite comfortable with, but talking about spirits, not so much. There seems to be a lot of confusion regarding spirituality and spirits. Many people either considering all spirits bad or all spirits good, and then perhaps even more not believing in the existence of spirits at all. Since an early age, I myself have had encounters with spirits that I wouldn't necessarily consider good. And with a Catholic upbringing that distorts understanding of spirits and angels, I personally found it best to not entangle myself in that world too much, in the hopes that a mutual recognition and respect will keep us all in our respective places.
Spirits are, they have the same range of dark and light, like people do.
Yeah. They get jealous. I mean, they get really mad.
Right.
Like, if I don't go their way, they get really bitter, mm-hmm. jealous, and they're possessive. So I asked my uncle about it. He was a medicine man. Uncle, why are spirits so jealous? It's because they have ADD.
What? What are you talking about?
They have attention deficit disorder.
No, I know what ADD is, but what does it mean?
That means they forget where they're from. They forget their purpose. They forget their goodness. It's not about them.
So spirits also have ego.
Yeah.
They just don't have a human form.
Yeah.
So why do we tend to revere them?
Because when they're helpful, they're helpful.
Mm-hmm.
You give thanks for helping. You know, there's spirits everywhere, all the time. When you get people that are having a hard time.
Yeah.
You know, there's always a way out. Spirit's always trying to guide you there.
And then the dark ones? What's their story?
Trying to keep you from that? Like, if you pay attention now, next time you go to a ceremony, you're gonna experience roadblocks. Something's always gonna come up in your life that's gonna try to prevent you to go there.
Mm-hmm.
In some shape or form, always.
Yeah, yeah.
That's why it's never gone. That's why you use cedar, sage. You use all that stuff to get it out. But sometimes they're not strong enough.
Would you agree that if there's still darkness in yourself, then it's easier for them to come and affect you? But the more you heal, the less relevant they are, the less they can have influence over you.
Yeah. But like I said, conscious decision.
Well, personally, I'm always trying to just talk to the creator because I don't know about all that other stuff, and that's scary.
Yeah. Yes. I do that too. Because sometimes I'm dealing with stuff that I'm scared for my life.
Will continues to recount more stories of spiritual afflictions, which were fascinating and got me thinking about the forces that may affect our everyday life. These forces are recognized in the shamanic roots of traditional Chinese medicine. Classics of the medicine reference pernicious influences, spiritual afflictions, and pathogens as evils. Legitimizing traditional Chinese medicine in the modern world means abandoning references to things deemed unscientific and superstitious, and embracing medicine that is reduced to what is observable and controlled. Since experiencing the profound effects of indigenous medicine, I've often wondered about the depths and breadth of medicine that has been lost in the pursuit of the rational. We've so severely reduced our experience and understanding of the world and life in this way, focusing the definitions of what is rational and worthwhile as defined by white, patriarchal, capitalist world system, that few people are able to get a hint that there is anything more, much less follow such an unconventional path as the Red Road. I asked Will about the road narrowing and why.
What happens to the people? Why does it start to get so few?
Because sometimes they're not stronger. They're not strong enough to continue. They fall off the wagon. They go back to drugs. They go back to alcohol. They get distracted. And there's a lot of distraction. Tons of it. More so than you can even imagine. The majority of the population, they will not understand it and they'll go crazy. That's why the medicine way is not for everyone. It's only the strong-minded ones, the sharp-minded ones. The simpletons will not get it and they'll misunderstand it, fear it, call it devil worshiping, call it whatever, you know, just to justify their anger because they're too dumb to get it.
Is it weak-minded or is it strong ego?
That's the same thing.
Okay.
It's the same thing.
Okay.
Because the ego is like overcompensating, but they're lacking.
Uh-huh.
It's the guys that don't have an ego that are like, oh, I want to listen to you.
I don't like to think about it like that, right? So my question is, how does a person become strong-minded then? Is it like you're either feeble-minded, you can't hear, you're dumb?
Okay, closed-minded.
Yeah, but is it so, are they just no use in helping them?
No, you can still help them, it'll just take you longer. And unless you have the time and compassion and patience for them, they'll get there eventually. But if you're busy and you've got to move on to the next person, let the next guy take care of that one. Because why waste your time when you're not going to see progress? once you're on the road and you go down and you meet enlightened people, like, can you imagine sitting in front of Buddha or Christ and understanding every single word? You're not going to understand every single thought.
Yeah.
It's going to take time to digest.
Mm-hmm.
So how much time do you have to sit with them
and
tutor them? Either they have the aptitude or they don't.
Well, no. See, that's what I don't.
Unfortunately, we're not equal.
True. And the way you're talking about it makes it feel like, so on my own journey, I feel so grateful to the things that I could hear along the way until I had more aptitude, until I had more and
exactly.
more aptitude.
That's what I'm talking about.
Right.
That's what I'm talking
so
about.
So I was feeble-minded.
Yeah, but then you got exposed and you took action, making a conscious decision.
So how does one develop that?
Conscious decision?
Why do some people get exposed and take action and understand truth versus their ego, and some people just go
They're
to the ego? Why is that more comfortable for some people than
some
others?
Some people don't have courage.
Why do some people have no courage?
Lack of heart.
Why
lack
do
of
some people have lack of heart?
Lack of self-help. Lack of self-love.
Why?
Abandonment issues.
Why?
That goes back.
So this is the healing that you're talking
back.
About for yourself.
Beginning since men walked.
Uh-huh.
I could feel myself become almost childlike with all my whys, and I couldn't wholeheartedly accept the picture that Will was painting regarding the narrowing of the road and people being too close-minded or feeble-minded. Perhaps I was touching upon my own issues of abandonment, but I didn't like the idea of leaving anyone behind. It didn't seem fair. And I can also see that this may not always be the healthiest ways, as I've been stuck in situations for far more years than necessary because of this stubborn idealism, or as some see it, denial. I continue to wonder, though, what does it take to choose and stay on a healing path? You are listening to KPFA's About Health. This is your host, Thuy Nguyen, and you are listening to a conversation I am having with William Verburg about the indigenous path of healing, the Red Road.
So the thing that is, your personal journey and hard work and all that is remarkable and very interesting. And I think in my work, what I'm always trying to do, because, you know, most people do not have access to them.
Bullshit. That's a cop-out.
Really?
Yes.
Think most people have access to going to peyote meetings
If they're sincere, Creator will give them away. Whether or not it's through the peyote, whether or not it's through whatever fits their prescription.
Yeah.
But the Creator always provides it, always gives them a path.
Right.
Now, whether or not they take conscious effort, that's the key. Conscious effort to do something about it, then they're full of shit.
Yeah.
Then they can talk about it all they want, write about it all they want, but to live it, they're not going to get it. They're not.
Because my experience is that people are desperate for it. They are talking about it all the
Good.
Time. They do want it
Good,
all the time.
Good, then pay attention.
I do find that people are desperate for healing and guidance on this realm, and that there are few avenues open and available. Some people think that these problems can be dealt with through therapy, yet few people have the resources to pursue that. Other people try some form of therapies associated with spirituality, like meditation or yoga, or any host of other metaphysical ways to process and understand these afflictions that they feel. The sheer number of New Age alternative practices speak to the growing need for healing. Acupuncture is often in this mix, as I find myself engaged in conversation around themes of emotional and spiritual healing in my practice. And so it seems that there is a lot available, and yet few find a sense of wholeness and peace within themselves. For myself, I had been searching for most all of my adult life before I landed in Navajo lands. And while it may seem good fortune that led me to connect to an indigenous healing ceremony that helped me understand my search, I don't think it was all just dumb luck. As Will related, Sincerity and conscious effort are important components. What is sincerity? It's somewhat related to humility, and it took me a long time to understand that despite me feeling like I was sincere and humble about my healing, I wasn't at all. I had too many ideas about what was right and wrong, too many ideas about how I was hurt and why, and what my healing needed to look like. I had too many ideas about myself, healing, and medicine to learn anything new. And it took many years of me trying to fulfill these ideas without success to finally admit that perhaps I didn't know anything and that there were other ways of understanding that I am incapable of, and then to sincerely ask for help, to really accept my limitations. That was the beginning. And then until I found more direction, I started with some very basic things. Sincere prayer, helping others the best I can, telling the truth, taking care of myself on the most basic levels, practicing the courage to set my ego aside and to be vulnerable, and then the hardest of all was to trust.
It takes effort. It takes work. I can't do the work for you. Your teacher can't do the work for you. The gurus can't do the work for you. You have to do it yourself. And you have to find a venue that works for you.
I agree. But here's the deal about that too, is that sometimes hard work looks different for different people.
That doesn't matter. It's your interpretation.
No, it does matter, because when we think about hard work, almost everybody thinks about this grueling, laborious process. But if you were raised with that mentality, then your hard work then is to trust that your personal will, which is oftentimes connected to ego, by the way, your personal hard work, you gotta let that go too. So I'm just kind of clarifying.
Okay, so
because
it's not self-prescribed. You don't self-prescribe your healing. You cannot. You don't know what you're dealing with.
Yes, I agree.
What I talked about earlier, firm ideas of why you are hurt and what is needed to remedy it, is what Will is reiterating when he says healing is not self-prescribed. It's a nice, succinct way to put it. And not just that I experience the limitations of that myself, but also because I observe it in my patients. It seems to me that the most challenging patients I have, interestingly enough, are the ones who are very versed in the healing fields and come to me with thought-out ideas of what is wrong, what is needed, and what healing should look like. They have diagnosed themselves and have self-prescribed their treatment. They seem to have it all figured out and just want me to be the conduit for what they already know. Of course, even if I follow their plan to a T, I can't help but fail, because healing doesn't work that way. And then they move on to the next practitioner. Sometimes I say, actually, I don't think we have it all figured out, at which point they move on to the next practitioner anyway. It's hard to see that the fixation on our healing and what it needs to look like is just a veiled attempt at maintaining control. But control is actually the very thing that we must give up to really allow ourselves to heal and to understand our true place in the world. When we maintain control at all costs, we are saying we know better than anyone, and we can only trust ourselves, and so we block out any help that anyone or anything else has to offer. It's a form of isolation, and we will eventually grow sicker that way, because life and health in its fullness is about connection, natural reciprocity, and trust. Goes on to talk about this path of the red road and how the healing road can become more difficult the longer one travels it.
So you, like you said, you trust.
Yes.
You trust the process. You trust what's presented to you
yeah.
in life.
Yeah.
Right. But then you also have to think is this going to help me or not help me?
Right.
Right.
But you have to even know what that means.
What does help mean? I think there's a lot of confusion about that in our modern world. Everything presents itself as help. We reach for things because it helps us deal with pain in the moment, even though it can make it worse later. But the modern life is very much about quick fixes and easy answers. We don't know what help means. We don't even know what the problem is. How can we know what help is? We're mostly just trying to stop the pain, and that often leads to addiction to things that temporarily distract us from the pain.
First thing I would suggest to anyone that asks me, stop drinking. Stop smoking weed. Stop doing ecstasy.
Stop smoking weed too? Same thing?
Oh my God. Yes.
Will's emphasis on abandoning alcohol and drugs as being essential to walking the red road reflects his journey with substance abuse, and perhaps the journey of many Native Americans as they walk the healing road. For my own life path, with a very different upbringing, those things weren't so seductive, and yet I still find the road not an easy one to walk, because distractions and seductions of a different sort remain, and more cleverly disguised. It's easy to demonize drug addicts and yet praise work addicts. The source of both addictions may be the same, a desperate escape from pain, but one benefits the American infrastructure and the other threatens it. Compulsive consumerism, media addiction, and while we're talking about drug addiction, pharmaceutical dependency, are all ways to escape our pain that are not only accepted but encouraged in America. This type of darkness takes advantage of our desires to escape pain. And if you want to get really dark, I can argue that America intentionally creates pain so that we become addicted to the so-called solutions it provides, which creates more pain, which creates more so-called solutions ad infinitum. So I would recommend to try to stop running away from pain in whatever you do, even if it's self-prescribed as healing, it's a running away. And to stop the compulsion to use things or to figure things out, which is another thing we do to keep from being present. To sincerely ask for help to be with whatever presents itself, even pain, and to trust what is being shown to us. No, the red road is not easy because it is a road outside of what we know and what we were taught to do to protect ourselves. The red road is not easy because to reckon with it means a willingness to confront a lot of ugliness, a lot of pain, both personal and societal, and to find another way. To trust that we don't need distractions from it, but a willingness to be with it and a great forgiveness of others and of ourselves. You are listening to KPFA's About Health. This is your host, Thuy Nguyen, and you are listening to a conversation I am having with William Verburg about the indigenous path of healing, the Red Road.
Because the way I see it, you have Creator. He created everything beautiful. But then you got the light and the dark, right? Yin and the yang.
Yeah, yeah.
Night and day.
Yeah.
The dark side wants to snuff it all out. The dark side wants to create havoc on what God created, because he still resents being kicked out. There is a dark entity, but they have worked together. But then it goes, it's mind-boggling. It is absolutely, I'm boggled by my God. He's the boss, but then you take care of the underworld or the dark stuff, but then you're also a teacher, because whenever the dark comes, it's showing me what I need to look at.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Some people won't want to acknowledge it.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. So that's the part I'm trying to say. Is when the dark comes up, they pretend it's not there and they ignore it.
Mm-hmm.
And the manifests further into their lives, car accidents, broken leg, paralyzation, whatever, to wake them up.
Mm-hmm,
but that's how hard the lesson has to be for them to wake up and turn their lives around.
Yes.
Because when they continue on their life path that way, they're going to death. They're not creating beauty along the way. They're just consuming the darkness, drinking, drugging, whatever. And that stuff is what's killing everything.
While this seems like a bleak picture, I assure you it's not. There is a greater force that is always directing us. Pain is painful because it is teaching us to move in another direction. And it is instinctive inside us. It's not a thing we have to work hard and learn. When a thing hurts, we want to move away. It's actually more work to override our instincts and to keep hurting than to move away. But even if we choose to keep hurting, this greater force is forever patient and will do what it takes until the message gets across. Sometimes this means hitting rock bottom for some people. Sometimes the lesson takes us into the next life. As for me, I'm not sure how many stubborn, feeble, closed-minded lives I've lived. Probably far too many. But I can say with some degree of certainty that I don't think I need any more lessons in pain and suffering. I forgive all those who have hurt me, and I forgive myself for all the stupid things I've done and all the hurt I've caused, both knowingly and unconsciously. I'm walking this healing red road with you in peace, love, and respect. Meeting Will on the road and talking to him has got me thinking. The concept of the red road is very new to me, and I'm not absolutely sure I'm on the road he's talking about. At times during our discussion, I felt quite the contrary. Just that it used to feel lonely on the road I was traveling, but now it feels expansive, inclusive, and beautiful. For me, rather than narrowing, the edges of the road are fading, and I hardly see a road at all. And everyone I meet teaches me something and gifts me something, and it always feels unpredictable. I used to travel on a very narrow road whose destination was picture perfect, and definitely better than where I was at the time, or have been. I used to run as fast as I could down that road, carrying as much as I deemed valuable with me, but all the time rushing to get there. Where? Someplace better than I was. Someplace of more of everything, including more healing. I traveled so fast, I was lucky if I met anyone at all along the way. They'd be like a blur. My life was a blur, and the destination seemed so far away. At some point, I got tired, and sometimes miserable. There were kind beings along the way that would whisper to me or offer help when I was too tired to keep going. Sometimes a teacher, sometimes a child, sometimes a plant, an animal, sometimes the wind. If I found it in me to stop and listen and ask for help, there was always help. Maybe this is what Will referred to as a conscious effort and sincerity. The more help I received, the more I wanted to give back out of appreciation. Before I knew it, I forgot about my destination. Life felt so beautiful that I stopped and strolled and played and offered help to others. I don't know if this is the red road, but it feels very healing. There's a Navajo prayer that I love. I love it because I love beauty, and the prayer transforms everything to beauty. When you can understand that everything, even the ugly and painful, has a beautiful reason, then life is transformed in you. In beauty, I walk with beauty before me, I walk. With beauty behind me, I walk. With beauty above me, I walk. With beauty around me, I walk. It has become beauty again. Today I will walk out. Today everything negative will leave me. I will be as I was before. I will have a cool breeze over my body. I will have a light body. I'll be happy forever. Nothing will hinder me. I will walk with beauty before me. I will walk with beauty behind me. I will walk with beauty below me. I will walk with beauty above me. I will walk with beauty all around me. My words will be beautiful. In beauty all day long may I walk. Through the returning seasons may I walk. On the trail marked with pollen may I walk. With dew about my feet may I walk. With beauty before me may I walk. With beauty behind me may I walk. With beauty below me may I walk. With beauty above me may I walk. With beauty all around me may I walk. In old age wandering on a trail of beauty, lively may I walk. In old age wandering on a trail of beauty, living again may I walk. My words will be beautiful. Thank you, William, for your work, companionship, and kindness on this healing road, for offering your stories to help others, and for gifting our Navajo Healing Project with your delicious and healing Vietnamese foods. Thank you to Joshua Dixon for your healing voice and song. And thank you to my partner and engineer, Daniel Burgess, for walking this road with me. If you'd like to know more about the Navajo Healing Project, you can go to NavajoHealingProject.com. To learn more about Berkeley Community Acupuncture, you can go to BCAClinic.com. If you'd like to contact me, you can write to Thuy@kpfa.org. Thuy is spelled T-H-U-Y. Thank you to everyone traveling this road with me. Slow down. There's no destination or opportunity that is better than here and now. At any moment, you can search your heart for forgiveness, ask for healing, and choose to love. Tune in again next week for another healing show at KPFA's 94.1 About Health.
It's not freedom when they take away your right to vote. It's not freedom when they dictate what your reproductive rights are. It's not freedom when they dictate what books you can read. It's not freedom to live in fear. Join the fight for freedom. Become a KPFA member today at kpfa.org.
Freedom, 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 freedom.
KPFA is on social media. Follow us on your favorite platforms for news headlines, live stream events, show info, and more. That's at KPFA 94.1 on Facebook and at KPFA Radio on Twitter, Instagram, YouTube, and TikTok.
Please join KPFA for a very special matinee Zoom event on Sunday, June 26 at 5 p.m. when we welcome Delegate Danica Rome and her new book, Burn the Page, a true story of torching doubts, blazing trails, and igniting change, in conversation with best-selling author Charlie Jane Anders, host of the award-winning podcast, Our Opinions Are Correct. An inspirational memoir meets manifesto by Danica Roem, the nation's first openly trans person elected to U.S. state legislature. Burn the Page is a colorful, no-holds-barred account of Roem's life and political work, which delights for its unabashed candor. An inspiring story of self-acceptance and determination. Tickets to Danica Roem and Conversation with Charlie Jane Anders on Sunday, June 26th are available at eventbrite.com or by visiting kpfa.org/events.
You're listening to 94.1 KPFA, 89.3 KPFB in Berkeley, 88.1 KFCF in Fresno, and online at kpfa.org.